So we are now close to Babaji's shrine in the Blossom Foundation Sacred Groves. Suddenly the temperature went down in the evening yesterday, so it's cold. Not so cold. And I thought this is the best setting to sit near the Babaji's temple in this grove-like structure. So we call it Sacred Grove. So without much delay, we need to start. It is called Under the Peepal Tree, but I think I am sitting under an oak tree here. Or whatever tree, I don't know. Oak, yeah. I think Buddha sat under the peepal tree because in India there were a lot of peepal trees. If he had come to Texas, he might have sat under an oak tree, so it's okay. So, here are the questions given to me. I'm not going to speak. Today's session will be trying to answer the questions more than anything else. I'm going to mix up the sequence of questions and ask what I can discuss more and then go to the next questions. If a person has a very strong unsatisfied desire, will it be an obstacle in his path to enlightenment? This is not the first question, this is 1, 2, 3, 4th question. But I think it's an interesting thing. First, let me tell you that if a person has a strong unsatisfied desire, I think everybody has some kind of a desire. Unsatisfied. It's not just one person. Most people have. So, it depends on what kind of desire. Is it a desire that is going to disrupt your spiritual life? Or is it a minor desire which will not interfere with your spiritual life? In that case, we don't even have to consider this question. Like, I have this strong desire to have coffee every day. It doesn't interfere with your sadhana. You can carry on having your coffee. But if that strong desire becomes a strong desire to drink vodka every day, there we need to watch what's happening and see what we can do about it. So, it's not a question of all desires, it's a question of what desires and how they are linked to your sadhana. That's the most important thing. Okay. Now, if you have a strong desire for a certain kind of food, for instance, is that an obstacle to your sadhana or not? This is what we have to see. If it is, then we need to work on how to get out of it. There are two ways of getting out of it. One is if you have a strong will, few people can do that. You completely avoid it. You don't look in that direction, you break it totally. Now this is very difficult for most people to do. So, in the ancient Tantra Shastras, they went and discovered another method, which is, Tantra is defined as yoga bhogayate, that means yoga through bhoga, yoga through enjoyment. So, that doesn't mean that Tantra is orgies in the regular orgies in the cremation grounds. It means understanding the fact that very few people can actually get rid of their desires, which are an obstacle to the path. Otherwise, it's okay. If you have a desire to buy a Buick and it doesn't interfere with your sadhana, that's fine. As long as you don't murder somebody to buy it, then you're okay. But desires, certain deep-seated desires, especially of sexual nature and food habits and so on. So Tantra says that you get rid of them by first enjoying it, because most people cannot totally get rid of it by abandoning it or avoiding it. So, because in this world it's difficult to avoid. Look at the ads and the world we live in, it's difficult to avoid. So, see that? Maybe there are ways and means by which you enjoy it. And then, if you're seriously enjoying it, to come out of it, not otherwise. If you're enjoying it for enjoying sake, then there's no hope of coming out. But if you feel that it is going to be an obstacle and you want to come out of it, that's the first thing, that I want to come out of it. Then you enjoy it, keeping in mind that you're doing it so that tomorrow it shouldn't become so obsessive that you're not able to move towards your spiritual journey, then it's allowed. But then it's nice to have a teacher with you who knows how to pull you out of it. Because what happens usually, like for instance, the desire for alcohol, it's habit producing. Once you have it, it's chemical, you want to have it again and again and again. In this case, if you really want to practice Tantra, it is very, very difficult and dangerous unless you have a teacher who knows how to pull you out of it. If the teacher himself is stuck in it, you're done. It's finished. But if that teacher is not a person who is a habitual drunkard, and if he drinks only once in a while and is able to coordinate and see what the disciple is doing, then it is possible for him to give him something to drink, and then before he gets completely addicted, to pull the person out of that. So there are two ways of doing it. One is by indulgence, but then remember that you form a conclusion beforehand that you're indulging so that you can finally be free of it. Not to remain in that forever, that you don't get addicted to it. So that requires a proper teacher who knows how to get out of it. First, he should be or she should be free of it and is doing it only for the purpose of freeing the disciple from it. Then there is a possibility that the obstacle can be overcome by enjoying and then discarding. Unfortunately, what happens is discarding never happens. There is only enjoying and enjoying. And then it becomes a habit and then you're stuck and done and gone. You might think when you're drunk you're in samadhi. That's a different matter altogether. It's not. So, this is very important to note. So, if you want to have a girlfriend or something, and your desire is to have an insatiable desire is to have a girlfriend, and then if you think you are moving on the spiritual, otherwise there is no problem. Please have 1, 2, 3 girlfriends, no problem. But if you are on the spiritual journey, you need to keep your mind unagitated and clear and tranquil. So then this becomes a big problem. So this is the same with engaging in enjoyment and getting out of it. It's not so easy. So you need guidance for that, proper guidance. Little things in life, there's no harm in enjoying it, carrying on with your sadhana. Like if you love to eat dosa, no harm. Or something else for that matter. Okay. I don't know who asked this question, but this is food for thought. So keep looking at it carefully to find out how to get out of it. If you want to get out of it, that's the key point. If you don't want to get out of it, this question doesn't apply. Fourteenth question, very simple question, is when I teach, I ask people to, when they breathe in and out, to chant Hum-Sau. There are some other disciplines where people chant Sau-Hum or Om. So the question is, can Hum-Sau be replaced with Sau-Hum or Om? How to reconcile these differences? And then there is a line after the question which says, you alluded to this topic in your interviews. So then why are you asking this? I might have explained it clearly why. Anyway. Maybe the person wants to hear it again. So, hum and saw are two sounds. It hardly makes any difference if you say hum saw or saw hum. The topic is over. There's nothing wrong. If you don't want to say hum saw, say saw hum. If there is someone whose name is Hare Krishna, and you want to call him Krishna Hari, it doesn't matter. The same thing. In the same way, instead of some Hum-Sau, if you want to say Sau-Hum, it doesn't mean anything. But let me explain. Hum means me. And Sau means that. So when you say Hum-Sau, it means I am that. Sau-Hum, that is me. It's the same thing. So it doesn't matter. These are unnecessary controversies which are taken up by cults, which say only this is correct, this is wrong, there is no such thing. You can say Hum-Sau or you can say Sau-Hum. And we're not building a cult here, okay? So it's all right. Now, Hum-Sau or Sau-Hum, both have a certain sound apart from the meaning. And that sound is conducive to quietening your mind, which is why it's attached, connected to the breath and while it's chanted. Some people chant even without connecting to the breath. That's also fine, no problem. Spirituality and professional career exert opposing forces on the mind. While the former helps still the mind, the latter stirs and churns it. I'm not so sure. How do we balance the two and keep making progress on the spiritual journey while advancing in the professional career at the same time? So, if you are seriously interested only in spiritual fulfillment, then you cannot keep the cake and eat it too. Either you eat it or you keep it. However, actually, nobody is so seriously interested in spiritual progress. I've seen many people, I've met hundreds of people. They're okay with spiritual progress as long as it doesn't interfere with their daily life. Yeah, if that's the case, then you need to find a balance between the two. And the balance depends on different people, on different situations. But let me tell you that you are moving towards the spiritual journey doesn't mean that you stop all work. Stopping all work is utter laziness. It's nothing to do with spirituality. Some people come to me, how old are you? I am 40 years old. So I want to give up all work and come to Madanapalli and stay with you. And I say, do what? Create mischief. Gossip. Carry stories. Is this spiritual life? It's better they work and then come and do their spiritual sadhana. Even things like doing yoga asanas, this is also work. It's not doing any work. It keeps your body and mind active. So I think there is no dichotomy between the two. Do your work. It doesn't mean that work churns you up and meditation makes you inert. It's not true. Meditation also churns you up, but in a better way, in a different way. And worldly life churns you up in a different way. So there are two ways. You need to find out how to link them together. And if you think that you'll give up work and come to an ashram and live in tranquility and peace, you are completely mistaken. There is no ashram that is tranquil. There is always somebody whispering. In fact, when you are in an ashram, it's a smaller setup, so it exaggerates. Outside world is so big that if this happens, nobody will know. When less number of people are there, then the politics and the self-differences, everything come to the fore, which is a good training for spiritual practice. But one takes it so seriously, then forgets the spiritual journey and one is only involved in that. This is the problem. So, you cannot give up and do anything because giving up is not in our hands. But if something falls off in its own natural way, then you are moving towards the spiritual field. And I totally disagree with people who say you have to give up all work so that you can move spiritually. Even if you come to a place which is spiritual, there's a lot of work. You need to work hard. Ask the volunteers who are here. How much work are they doing? It's not they're not doing. But work not for self, but work for others. In this case, I don't know if you're doing it for Blossom Foundation or you're doing it for me, I don't know. But not for the self, certainly. That much I agree. Yeah, for the self in the ultimate sense, because what you are looking for is salvation for yourself, not for me, right? So that is there. So understanding all this, if we move forward, then it's possible to do both together. Now, if your professional career is smuggling or murdering or being part of a gang, then better to give it up and be spiritual. If you are a doctor or something like that, it's a wonderful thing. You can change it and do it more good for others and carry on, and then also meditate and move forward. This is possible. What I'm trying to say, I'm not saying that you can do everything that is bad on earth and say that this is professional career and still try to, this doesn't work. You need to make some changes. Then you can do it. Does the guru choose his or her disciples? Or is there choice for the disciple to choose the guru? Any comment? I'm not so sure. I think one should utilize one's intelligence and try to, limited intelligence maybe, who has unlimited intelligence, and try to figure out which teacher is suitable for one and take it up. Practice sincerely what is being said, live with the person and find out what's happening. If you find that it is not taking you on the right path, don't hesitate to change and find somebody else. But this finding somebody else should not go on forever, because by the time you are dead. So at some point, find the best possible among the teachers. Nobody is perfect. As long as you have a human body, some imperfections will be there. So you choose accordingly. However, if you have already spiritually advanced during many births, have come to a stage where you need just a little bit of a turn, then the guru will choose you. Till then, don't put your brains into the freezer and say the guru is going to choose me and I'll do nothing. Nobody will come. The more you move, Ramakrishna Paramahamsa said it nicely, you take one step towards the deity and the deity takes two steps towards you. So that one step is essential. And choose something that suits you, not something that doesn't suit you. If somebody says all the time, you shouldn't do any work, simply sing bhajans. How many people can do that? So you'll get frustrated in the end. The teacher will get frustrated in the end and everything will go. So find someone who's, I'm not recommending myself, but find someone who's like you, who walks like you, talks like you, but is actually not like you. That is better. And a spiritual teacher is always on the lookout for a good student. So the moment he finds, the regret every morning when you wake up is, oh my God, I haven't found anybody. So therefore, if you are ready, then partly the question is right. One chooses a disciple. Do dreams have any significance or meaning? For example, I had a vivid dream of being in a temple of a goddess whom I had never seen before. Later I came to know that it was Linga Bhairavi. Is there any meaning to a dream like this? I really don't know what Linga Bhairavi is. I know of Bhairavi and I know of a Linga. If there is a Linga Bhairavi, I'm not so sure. So if somebody went to a temple and saw some image, maybe the dream is all messed up. You might have seen some Devi and you saw this and you are so hypnotized into it that you say, this is Linga Bhairavi. Because usually there is so much paraphernalia that one gets hypnotized. Then 19. Meditation leads to infinite energy and unlimited wisdom, leading to the truth and everlasting happiness. Why then was this creation made to crave and go through multiple lives to finally merge in the very divine that created it? The corollary to this question is, if during this life one does not attain the ultimate bliss, will death reveal the truth? No. Death will not reveal the truth. And the other question, I don't know the answer. Why? There are many whys which we don't know, but we know it is so. Why is there gravity on this earth? Why is the earth revolving around the sun? Anybody knows why? Not even astronomers know why. But can you say that is not doing it? It is. So the fact is, we are craving for that divine, and the source is divine. Why we are separated, we don't know, but we are separated and we are looking for it. So let's be frank and don't go into stories. The fact is that we are separated and we are looking for it, and the puny brain can never find the why until it reaches the goal. And when it reaches the goal and finds the why, it cannot explain to someone who hasn't. But the fact remains that we are craving. That we cannot deny. Why is it important to meditate early in the morning at Amrita Vela? Does it make any difference if one does it later in the day? Very good reasons why you should meditate early in the morning, because that's the time when everything is silent and one has not started one's day, one has not gone to the office, the fight with the boss has still not surfaced. Well, sometimes a fight with the boss may start in the morning if the wife is the boss, but anyway. So early in the morning it's so fresh and nice. So you can, your mind is fresh, and that's the time when meditation is good. That's the simple reason. So they have made sandhya in the morning, because then the day is ending, after the night is ending, and the day is coming, and the junction between the two, there's a beautiful sun rising, the birds chirping, there's a gentle breeze, you're not at caught in the world, nice time to meditate. So, however, if you find some time, quietness during the day, in any place, you may certainly meditate. There is no problem about that. However, I still suggest it's better to meditate early in the morning. It has been my experience, and my meditation in the mornings has been much better than meditating at some other time. I also wanted to say something, but please don't imitate me. I hardly meditate nowadays. But don't imitate me, I have also reached, so I don't want to meditate. I worked very hard, long time. So I do, even then I enjoy meditating. Especially in the evening, at dusk, when all your work is over, meditation is better than vodka. That destroys you, this takes you up. There's a difference. People can't give up. It's so difficult. Lifelong habits. This is a nice question. Even an 8-year-old Sanjana, why do you write books, Guruji? Well, Sanjana, I write books because I can't help writing books. But I have a natural tendency to put down in words what I feel and what I went through and my experiences, and writing is the best media for that. Not a short video, I mean it doesn't, but this is like you sit down, you spend your time, you write, nobody bothers you. So writing is a good way of expressing. I suggest to Sanjana that she should also start writing now. This age, if she starts writing, after a while, she'd be able to really write well. It's one thing to feel, it's another thing to write, because when you write, you should be able to express it properly. Well, here's a question, I don't know whether to take it up. Hmm. Here is a question. I am totally stumped by this question, and I don't know whether I can answer this question. We are lucky to have in our midst you in our midst. You have had the good fortune of meeting Krishna in your past lifetime, and you seem to have a memory of it. I love the word seem. When you get a chance, would you please draw a picture of Krishna? I can't. I don't have. We don't have in this world sufficient paints and brushes and canvas to draw that. Whatever I draw will fall short, so it's better to keep quiet. Can you please tell us why great saints like Sai Baba and Ramana Maharishi not stress on or teach yoga practices? Now this is a question. People like Sai Baba, when I say Sai Baba, there's only one Sai Baba for me, Shirdi Sai Baba. People like Sai Baba fall under the category of avdutas. They don't teach by actually asking you to do this or that. But if you are a practitioner of sadhana, in their presence your sadhana becomes good. They don't teach. Their function is not to teach. Their function is to be there, present, so that you derive whatever benefits are possible from them. Nityananda Avaduta of Ganeshpuri was a great Avaduta himself. He didn't teach anybody anything, but the presence can teach. They don't need to teach. Then there is one category of teachers who teach because they are filled with so much bliss and understanding that they want to share it with others. And there are others who teach because they have been asked to teach. The thankless job of teaching. So there are many kinds of. So Sai Baba, Nityananda, they all fall in. Now as far as Ramana Maharishi is concerned, it's a different category altogether. You can't say that Ramana Maharishi did not teach or did not ask anybody to do practices. When you say yogic practices, does yoga simply mean the yoga of meditation or the yoga of practice or kriya yoga or yoga asanas? Ramana Maharishi didn't do any asanas. He didn't practice any kriya. But he did teach people that you have to find out who you are. That's a teaching. And it is a yogic teaching. That yoga is called jnana yoga. Not that it's not a yoga. So he is not in that category of Sai Baba or... He's in a different category altogether. I fully appreciate his way of life and respect him for that. But unfortunately, one cannot become a Ramana Maharshi. I feel that while the search and inquiry is a wonderful way of trying to find the self, it's a very difficult path. It's not so easy. Although people might think it's easy. For Ramana Maharshi it was easy, but not for everybody. You cannot imitate. If you go to Tirunamalai, you'll find a lot of people wearing cowpeans, sitting down and saying, who am I? Who am I? You don't find who you are by chanting, who am I? You can as well chant idli, idli, idli. I mean, it doesn't mean anything. You should know how to make the idli. So, that's not, you can't imitate. Ramana Maharshi reached this place, perhaps through countless lives of sadhana. Now I, who am here, I'm trying to, it's not so easy, but it's a good path. Jnana Marga is a good path. Can one take the Guru Mantra from multiple Gurus if the need arises to acquire knowledge and wisdom? You are free to take Guru Mantras from anybody. Take multiple Gurus. Go to 100 Gurus, take 100 Mantras and keep chanting them and croak before you die. You There's a question I don't want to answer. Who was Madame Blavatsky, etc.? What is the correct way of chanting Loka Samasta Sukhino Bhavantu? Or Samasta Loka Sukhino Bhavantu? Well, traditionally it is Loka Samasta Sukhino Bhavantu. You can, grammatically it's not incorrect to say Samasta Loka Sukhino Bhavantu. As far as the language is concerned, no harm. Om Bhur Bhuvaswaha or Om Bhur Bhuvaswa. It is Om Bhur Bhuvaswa, not Swaha. Swaha is a different mantra altogether. People think, because most of the times when the priests chant, they say Swaha, so they think it might be correct, but it is Om Bhur Bhuvaswa. Swa, it is Bhuloka, Bhuvaloka, Swargaloka. Short form. Swaha is not the short form for Swarga. Now there is a question, what is sadness? Do we need to look at this? We all know what is sadness. So, sadness comes to every human being at some point. We don't know when it comes, how it comes, and it could be because we are deprived of something, it could be because we don't know where to move, it could be because we are so troubled by things. So all these contribute to sadness. Now I'm going to tell you something very interesting. What we usually do when we are sad is to bring on some entertainment so that we are free of it. But that's like sweeping the sadness under the rug. Well, it might be required sometimes, like when you have a headache, you need to take an Vicoril or paracetamol or something like that. But that's temporary, but the headache will come back unless you find the root source of the headache. Now, to find the root source of the headache, you need to get rid of the headache temporarily. I agree fully with Karl Marx when he said, religion is the opiate of the masses. Yes, but sometimes when you are seriously suffering, you need an opiate. Without that, you can't even think, right? So that's okay. But then when you think, the root of sadness isn't that we are not complete, we are missing something. We feel empty, we feel rejected, therefore we feel dejected. We feel loss of trust all around. We thought this is life and we find it is not. We think that if you do this, 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 then I'll be happy. I did it, but I'm not happy. There are multiple ways why we feel sad. But the feeling of sadness is common to all human beings. A small child feels sad when it is deprived of some food which it loves to have. Or when the mother scolds, when the child fails in the exam, it feels sad. On the higher level, the employee feels very bad when the boss says, you're useless, you're inadequate. The patient feels very bad when he trusted a doctor and then found that it's not right, that he's still suffering. So, sadness is of many kinds. So, to be free of, there's nothing to be, some sadness is nice. You can also learn to enjoy some kind of sadness. There are people who listen to sad songs and enjoy. Yeah. What are you enjoying? It looks like a contradiction, but it's... In India, we had an old singer called K.L. Saigal, always singing, Jab dil hi toot gaya, my heart is broken, my heart is broken. And there are people who listen to it in the night after a peg of whiskey and enjoying. What are you enjoying? Somebody saying, my heart is totally broken. So, you can also enjoy sadness. Okay, if you don't like to enjoy sadness, while it's sometimes you need to survive, so good to sweep it under the rug for some time, but always pick up the rug and see where it is, so that you can deal with it on a permanent basis. And the only way to deal with it in a permanent basis is to come face to face with it. When you come face to face with it, you'll see that sadness has lost its sting. Dukh to apna saathi hai. Then sadness becomes your friend and it no longer can threaten you. You're always happy. Not easy, but it's possible. Maybe it's easy. We make it too complicated. One hour should be enough. No? Less? 1 hour? 10 more minutes? When I practice Kriya, I get very hot. Is a man or a woman? Is this a purification of energy moving? Or is this normal? Yeah, that's true. The best time to practice Kriya is winter, because it warms up the body. There's nothing wrong in the body getting heated up during Kriya. It is a purification of energy moving. It's a burning out of all dross that is in your system. And it's quite normal, so nothing to worry about. How does one focus on the Ajna Chakra correctly? The easiest way to focus on the Ajna Chakra, if you want to focus on the Ajna Chakra, is one to knock a few times. Here, little above the middle of the forehead. Fix your attention there. Or take a feather or something and slowly tickle. Fix your attention there. For some people, when they close their eyes and fix their attention, automatically there's some feeling there, so they can remain there. Or use a pin. Don't puncture your skin, but slowly poke it and fix your attention there. And Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa's guru, Vedanta guru, Totapuri, came to see him. He was then worshipping the mother goddess. Totapuri was a total Vedantist. He didn't have any mother goddess. When he said, can I teach you Vedanta? He said, I'll ask my mother. He thought his mother was living with him. So when he came back in the temple, he said, oh, that is okay. And then he said, fix your attention in the middle of the forehead. Break through all images and be free. He broke through all images except the mother. And then Totapuri said, use your mind as a sword and cut her into two. He couldn't do it. I mean, all these years, how can you do it? So then he picked up a glass piece and poked it into his forehead. Actually bled a little bit. And he said, feel the pain there, fix your attention there. Don't think of anything else. So he sat. And everything was over. Mother, son, daughter, all finished. He went into Nirvikalpa Samadhi for 3 days. So, since the question is how to fix your attention, don't imitate Totapuri or Ramakrishna and take a piece of glass and poke it into your forehead. But do something so that your attention doesn't wander and is fixed here. The other thing would be to have something warm placed here so that you feel the warmth. The other way is to have a candle, look into the flame for some time, then close your eyes and bring the flame here. This is also possible. Blue light is very conducive to fix your attention on the Ajna Chakra. So if you go inside, there is blue light, you can sit there and fix your attention. So different ways of doing it.
go.
One person says, I'm feeling hot, another says, I feel cold. Sir, I have been doing Chakradharana meditation. I feel strong energy in my Sahasrara and Ajna. I also feel some energy in my Vishuddhi and Anahata. But I don't feel energy in the lower three chakras. Can I do anything to enhance the meditation? Last question. Yes, you can. There is no harm if you don't feel anything in the lower chakras. It's okay what you feel in the higher chakras, Sahasrara. No problem at all. Continue to do that and at some point you will begin to feel at the lower chakras also. But there is no harm. There are some disciplines where people don't touch the lower chakras at all and fix their attention only above this. So that's fine, no problem. There's one form of yoga. In fact, the great avaduta Nityananda of Vajreshwari, Ganeshpuri, said that going to the Muladhara and coming up has some dangers in it. But starting here and is safer for most people. Because he said it's like standing outside the well and putting a bucket in and pulling out water. He said to start from Muladhara is like to get down into the well. On slippery steps, it's possible that you might fall inside. So, different ways of looking at it. So that's why we give safety precautions when you do these things, so that you don't slip and fall inside the pit. You know what the pit is? Muladhara is the center of desire. That is the pit. You might suddenly see riches and good things coming your way, and then all other upper chakras are forgotten. That's the danger, nothing else. Okay, shall we stop? Cold? I'm sorry we had to sit here. But I enjoyed it. This is the best place. What? There's no live, right?
No. Okay. We'll stream the slate.